May God Almighty, by whose providence our Savior Christ came among us in great humility, sanctify with the light of his blessing this Advent wreath, and may he whose second coming in power and great glory we await make us steadfast in faith, joyful in hope, and constant in love.
Amen.
Our King and Savior now draws near.
O come, let us adore him. We light this first candle of Advent, O Lord, knowing full well that there are signs in the sun and moon and stars, and in the common events of our ordinary life that call us to attend to your coming. Prepare us for the time of trial and for your dominion coming now and at the close of this age.
Light and peace in Jesus Christ our Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
Blessed are you, holy and living one.
You come
to set your people free.
Almighty God, you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, give us grace to cast away the works of darkness and put on the armor of light. Now in the time of this mortal life in which your Son, Jesus Christ, came to visit us in great humility, that in the last day when he shall come again in his glorious majesty to judge both the living and the dead, we may rise to the life immortal. Through him who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Oh, that you would tear open the heavens and come down, so that the mountains would quake at your presence, as when fire kindles brushwood and the fire causes water to boil, to make your name known to all your adversaries, so that the nations might tremble at your presence. When you did awesome deeds that we did not expect, you came down, the mountains quaked at your presence. From ages past, no one has heard, no ear has perceived, no eye has seen any God besides you, who works for those who wait for him. You meet those who gladly do right, those who remember you in your ways. But you were angry, and we sinned. Because you hid yourself, we transgressed. We have all become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy cloth. We all fade like a leaf, and our iniquities, like the wind, take us away. There is no one who calls on your name or attempts to take hold of you, for you have hidden your face from us and have delivered us into the hand of our iniquity. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father, we are the clay, and you are our potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be exceedingly angry, O Lord, and do not remember iniquity forever. Now consider, we are all your people. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Darkness struck on.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you, because of the grace of God that has been given you in Christ Jesus. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking in any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The Word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
Jesus said, "In those days after that suffering, the sun will be darkened and the moon will not give its light, and the stars will be falling from heaven, and the powers in the heavens will be shaken. Then they will see the Son of Man coming in clouds with great power and glory. Then he will send out the angels and gather his elect from the four winds, from the ends of the earth to the ends of heaven. From the fig tree learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also when you see these things taking place, you know that he is near, at the very gates. Truly I tell you, this generation will not pass away until all these things have taken place. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. But about that day or hour no one knows, neither the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. Beware, keep alert. for you do not know when the time will come. It is like a man going on a journey. When he leaves home and puts his slaves in charge, each with his work, and commands the doorkeeper to be on the watch. Therefore, keep awake, for you do not know when the master of the house will come, in the evening, or at midnight, or at cockcrow, or at dawn, or else he may find you asleep when he comes suddenly. And what I say to you, I say to all, keep awake. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ. Well, you haven't seen me for a couple of weeks, and now it's probably obvious why. If you didn't know, I had a planned, expected foot surgery a couple of weeks ago. It all went well. I'm recovering beautifully. I feel great and glad to have gotten it done. But I was away for 2 weeks because the doctor's orders were lie down, keep that foot up, and rest. Rest. Because, of course, rest, we know, promotes healing. It really does. It helps that bone knit together. It helps that incision wound to heal back up. And so I've been following doctor's orders and resting almost completely for the last couple of weeks. And now I'm glad to be here because we're beginning the season of Advent. So much is different today, right? We had to really think through this, to light an Advent wreath, to get out the blue vestments, which reside in a drawer up higher than anyone can reach. And it's great because it reminds us it's a new year. The rest of the world begins the year on January 1st. The church begins the year on the first Sunday of Advent, usually right around Thanksgiving time. And so here we are today. We begin a new lectionary. So we're in year B, right, Mother Margaret? Year B, so we read from the Gospel according to Mark most of this year, as we did today. So we get to revisit the Gospel according to Mark, which we haven't read from in quite a while. And we get to have this wonderful season of Advent. And so these four Sundays, I want to focus on a verb in each of the Gospels coming up this week and the next three that remind us a little bit about what this season of Advent is about. And I love it because today's verb is keep awake. Right? We sang it in the hymn. It was the last two words of the Gospel reading that Jesus says. He says, what I say to you, I say to all, including you and me, keep awake. And for me, this year in particular, hobbling around on these crutches, it's a great contrast to my doctor's orders for the last couple of weeks when he said to rest. And now Jesus is saying to us, keep awake. And it's great because the season of Advent really is about that. There certainly are times in our lives, just like I've had physically the last couple of weeks, where what we need to do is to retreat, to stop, to be quiet, to rest and renew. But that's never the point. One doesn't get a surgery in order to rest and recover afterwards. One gets a surgery and rests and recovers because there's something more to do. There's something more in the future. We're looking ahead and wanting to be able to do what we're supposed to do in our lives. And the same is true with our spiritual rest and renewal. That's not generally the point of our spiritual life or our life of faith. We do that. We take time to rest, to renew, to be quiet, so that we can be about the work God's given us to do. What's tricky about this work, and what we remember during Advent as well, is that the end of this is not always clear. We don't always have all the answers, and that's okay. Jesus reminds us today that a lot of what the kingdom of God is about, a lot of what this looks like as the kingdom unfolds in our midst, is unexpected, surprising, and apparently possible to miss. If we fall asleep, if we get distracted, if we start looking the other way, we can miss all kinds of ways that God is at work in our lives and in the world. So we have the season of Advent. As we prepare to celebrate the Incarnation, as we prepare to celebrate Christmas, God in our midst in the person of Jesus, we get these four Sundays to focus on those things we need to do to be ready, right? And so today, the verb is keep awake. And there are certain ways that we do that, myriad ways that we can do that in our spiritual lives. We can just simply read the Bible. We're beginning a new year. Read the Gospel according to Mark. It's not that long. It's a great book to read all the way through. It moves along. It's a wonderful story of Jesus' life and ministry and death and resurrection. but study the Bible. Join a class or a discussion. We have all kinds of adult classes for adults and youth and children. Jump online and join us. There's some great stuff we're doing. Spend some more time in prayer than you do. That actually, one way to keep awake is actually, for us, it's actually to be quiet. That may seem odd, but it's one of the ways we keep awake. And so maybe spend 5 or 10 or 15 minutes each day. Set it aside. Just be quiet and breathe and just be open to God. All you have to do is sit and say, God, I'm open. Here I am. I'm yours. Ask for the grace during the season of Advent as we work to keep awake. Ask for the grace to deepen our empathy, our compassion for those who are suffering, for those who are oppressed. Because we know that one of the primary ways that we come to know, as you said last week, Mother Margaret, that we come to see God is in the lives of those who are suffering. As we live in solidarity with them, as we work to relieve others' suffering, as well as possibly our own, we come to know God deeply in that place. So Happy New Year. Let's be on this journey together. Let's get excited about what's coming. Lord knows we're ready to put this past year behind us. I don't know anyone who's not. I have not met anyone yet who's saying, oh, I'd repeat 2020. No, we know that. But what I also know is that as hard as this year's been, there's something more for us. 2021 has all kinds of great things in store for us. It may not be easier, it may be harder, no promises from God, but God is at work in our lives, in our community here, in all kinds of ways. And it's so easy when we're home alone, when we've got so many things beyond our control weighing on us, it's easy to stop paying attention and to just think the world is going to hell, but it's not. It's not. And God depends on us to ensure that that becomes abundantly clear day by day. And so this first Sunday of Advent, as we begin this new year, as we begin this season, as we begin our time and our journey toward the celebration of the Incarnation, let's take those words of Jesus to heart every day and keep awake. Let us stand and proclaim our faith with the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father of the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
In peace we pray to you, Lord God, for all people in their daily life and work,
for our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone,
for Donald, our president, Joe, our president-elect, Ron, our governor, and the mayor and members of the town council, for this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of your creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister to the sick, the friendless, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Peter, our bishop, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord.
For your mercy is great.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
And praise your name forever and ever.
We pray for all who have died, especially Freddie, and those we now name silently and aloud, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom.
Let light perpetual shine upon them.
Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Who put their trust in you.
We pray to you also for the forgiveness of our sins. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father.
In your compassion, forgive us our sins, known and unknown, things done and left undone. And so uphold us by your Spirit, that we may live and serve you in newness of life, to the honor and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Peace be with you. Good morning. Once again, this first Sunday of Advent, this new year, as we move into to this new liturgical season, lots happening. Really, the weekly email is the way to really keep track of what's going on, because things are, again, changing and evolving with this pandemic and what we can do and what we can't do. But this morning we had an 8 a.m. in-person outdoor service in the Garden Chapel. Our expectation is to continue having that service at 8 a.m. on Sundays for the foreseeable future. And so that will be there. Our hope, we cannot do it right now for some technical reasons that we're hoping to get fixed, but we hope soon we'll begin a 10 a.m. in-person service. That will be in the Garth when we can do it. So watch the email blast for when that will begin, because we just don't know when we can get, we have audio system, sound system issues that we need to get resolved and a couple of other logistical things. But we're working hard on that. We have people coming, engineers coming this week to look at it. So we're trying to get that going. Again, don't forget the expectation is outside, being outside does not mean it's safe. It simply means that it's less risky. So we expect that if you come to the outside services, our in-person services, we will all wear masks, we will maintain safe distances, we'll follow our protocols. And if you're not feeling well or not comfortable doing that, we continue our 11 a.m. streaming service and our coffee hour following, which is great stuff. That's not going to stop. And so if that works for you and you're comfortable with that, that's a great way. We'll still be there. And then don't forget that we'll also continue our 1:30 p.m. to 2:30 p.m. Sunday afternoon in the church for private prayer and communion, just sort of one by one. That's not a service as much as it is just an opportunity for that quiet private prayer and to receive communion from that 11 o'clock service, from this service. So that all will continue. What else? We've got the Angel Tree, one of our wonderful annual outreach events. We're going to do this year our Angel Tree, where customarily the way we do it is that walking out of church, one would take an ornament off the tree, buy the gift that's on the ornament, wrap it, and we're working on how to do this in a hybrid way so that people online can still participate in this, because we have a lot of people who need a little love and attention and this Christmas. And so that's going to happen. Be, again, on the lookout in the email newsletter for Angel Tree. We'll have more information about exactly how we're going to make that work. And then what else? Thank you. Oh, right. That's right. So we had our gratitude offering that we've been doing all this last month. And we've had some great notes and letters and cards from people with their gratitude gifts. And we are grateful for those gifts and that support, absolutely. But it's been really heartening to read the things that people are saying in the face of all the craziness this year. There are things to be grateful for. And so you'll see a little sort of word art that captures the essence of a lot of all those things for which people are grateful. A lot of them were repeat things. I'm always heartened when people say they're grateful for their church and their clergy and staff and things like that. But there were a lot of things. And so you'll see that in that word art as a way to acknowledge those gifts. But thank you to everyone who participated in that. Can they still participate? If someone forgot, it may not get on the word art, but can they still make a gratitude gift?
Absolutely. We'll keep the campaign open online through the end of
Good.
The year. So
Good.
We welcome that. Encourage everybody to think about what they're grateful for.
Yeah, because there are lots of great things to be grateful for this year, despite the craziness that we live in. And finally, you've heard about our Christmas worship is going to be a little different this year. We're going to have beautiful online worship and a really beautiful, wonderful new in-person worship liturgy, Christmas liturgy called a Christmas pilgrimage. And that's going to be take place on the evenings of the 22nd, 23rd, 24th of December. Three evenings, and you will need to make a reservation for that. You know, when you normally have 2,000 people for Christmas services and you go down to about 200 each night or something like that, space is limited. So we've not made this public yet. We've only announced this to parishioners, to people who are here, but you'll want to call and make reservations to come join us if you want to come to that in-person service. There's a better description of it, again, in the email newsletter. Is there a description on our website? Yep. I think that's coming up this week on our website, so take a look at that. And you can always call the office to ask about it. But a lot of great things happening. I'm excited about it.
And make that reservation before we make it public.
Yes, please make the reservation, because once it's public, I think it'll fill up in a matter of no time. Anything else, Stuart, Margaret? Great.
I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship.
Thank you.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is truly right and good and joyful to give you thanks, all holy God, source of life and fountain of mercy. Because you sent your beloved Son to redeem us from sin and death, and to make us heirs in him of everlasting life, that when he shall come again in power and great triumph to judge the world, we may without shame or fear rejoice to behold his appearing. Therefore, joining with angels and archangels and with the faithful of every generation, we lift our voices with all creation as we sing. Blessed are you, gracious God, creator of the universe and giver of life. You formed us in your own image and called us to dwell in your infinite love. You gave the world into our care that we might be your faithful stewards and show forth your bountiful grace. But we failed to honor your image in one another and in ourselves. We would not see your goodness in the world around us. And so we violated your creation, abused one another, and rejected your love. Yet you never ceased to care for us and prepared the way of salvation for all people. Through Abraham and Sarah, you called us into covenant with you. You delivered us from slavery, sustained us in the wilderness, and raised up prophets to renew your promise of salvation. Then in the fullness of time, you sent your eternal word, made mortal flesh in Jesus. Born into the human family and dwelling among us, he revealed your glory, giving himself freely to death on the cross. He triumphed over evil, opening the way of freedom and life. On the night before he died for us, our Savior Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Remembering his death and resurrection, we now present to you from your creation this bread and this wine. By your Holy Spirit, may they be for us the body and blood of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Grant that we who share these gifts may be filled with the Holy Spirit and live as Christ's body in the world. Bring us into the everlasting heritage of your daughters and sons, that with all your saints, past and present and yet to come, we may praise your name forever. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever.
Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The gifts of God for the people of God. Let us pray. O God, who bids us wait in this season of longing,
as you have fed us with the body of Christ, make us hungry for Christ's justice in the world.
As you have given us drink from the cup of salvation,
make us thirsty for the fullness of your kingdom.
In these days of expectation, stir our hearts and awaken hope,
that we may share the gifts of your reconciling love with all creation.
Amen. May the sun of righteousness shine upon you and scatter the darkness from before your path, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always.
Amen. Amen.
in peace to love and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.